for the next paper, that's the 2013 paper. In this session, we will discuss paper 1, section A only. We'll cover section B in a separate lecture. Now, the first question here was difference between the normal cycle and the arid cycle of Davis. Now, we have already talked about the cycle of Davis in this video. You can refer that. When you answer this question, you must start with the basic idea propounded by Davis. The normal studies that Davis did was under a humid or a normal cycle of erosion. So he talked about a landscape trio, where landscape is a function of three elements. That's the structure, process and the stage. Then you must work and explain the differences between the normal cycle and the arid cycle of erosion. So you must start with the differences that exist in form of or the manner of runoff. Then you have the formation of relief features that are more in case of youth in comparison to the mature stage. The next that you must explain here is the highlands are actively dissected in the youth stage, and finally you have the base level which is continuously uplifted, and that is due to the process of aggradation that occurs. So these are some of the basic fundamental points that you must touch while you are explaining the normal cycle and the arid cycle. Under arid cycle, you won't have a continuous stream fed system, so that would be again a drawback for the arid cycle. Here the main element is wind, and here the main element under the normal cycle or the humid cycle is water. The next question is differentiate storm surge and seiches. Now seiches occur in a partially bound water system. So you have the standing waves that are formed. So this is an example of seiche. And when you talk about surge, it's you have the normal high tide, and when you have a storm high tide that occurs, it is much higher as compared to the normal high tide, and that is known as surge. Now surge is usually created when you have a significant low pressure weather system that exists in the atmosphere, and that leads to a main feature which is known as coastal flooding. So it occurs along the coast and causes coastal floods. So for this question, you must explain both these by help of diagram. Now the next question is uniqueness of fauna in case of notogenean relief. Now a similar question was asked in 2012 again. Now what is important here to understand is the notogenean means the Australian relief. So you must draw a world map explaining the region of Australia and the reliefs there. So you must explain the first of all, this relief is divided into three parts, the northwest, southeast and central. And then you must explain the marsupials. Marsupials are the main animals that are found here. You have nearly 18 species that are endemic to this region. Then you have presence of rodents and placental animals. Also, you have prototherians that are mainly present in this region. So these are some of the major fauna that exist in this region. The next is impact of Pleistocene ice age on the crust of Earth. Now when we talk about the Pleistocene ice age, it's important that it existed around 1.5 million years ago. Now this phase was divided into two sections, the glacial and the interglacial section. Now when we talk about glacial, it talked about accumulation of ice. However, when we talk about interglacial phase, it talks about retreat of ice. Now, to understand this better, you have a presence of ice. Now, when you have a presence of ice on the surface, that would lead to pressure and that would lead to sinking of the region. This sinking of the region occurs when ice is melted, and this leads to isostatic adjustment that we have talked about under the study of isostasy. This isostatic adjustment led to formation of numerous lakes towards the northern hemisphere in India. So formation of five great lakes in North America is a result of retreat of glacier. Then you have the formation of Baltic Sea in Europe. That's again a result of this. And you have the formation of Hudson Bay in Canada. That's again a result of the isostatic adjustments. Now again, when we talk about ice sheets, you have ice sheets that lead to formation of glaciers. Glaciers increase the albedo and lead to climatic cooling. So that's another important feature that is seen under this. Now next is types of endemic plants and degree of vulnerability to extinction. Now when we talk about the types of endemic plants, we'll first explain the IUCN classification that was given. So you have on one side you have extinct, that is EX, then you have EW, that's extinct in the wild. So they are not present in wild, however they could be seen in preserved areas. Then you have the threatened species, you have the near threatened species and the least concerned species, which we are not aware of or which we are not considering. Now you have the endangered, vulnerable and critically resourced animals that are seen here. Now when we talk about the endemic plants, so the question focuses only on plants, we must cite down certain examples that are must for this question. So some of the good examples that you can cite is Rafflesia, that's the world's biggest flower, is endemic to the region of Borneo and Sumatra. Then you have the honey climbers, or we call them as Palila, which are the Hawaiian honey creepers or honey climbers, and these are found on manane trees. Now they are endemic to the region of Hawaii, and the destruction of the lot of water logging in that region has led to destruction of the native region. As a result, this species, which is endemic to Hawaii, is on the verge of extinction. So these are some of the important species. Besides these, one of the most important species is redwoods, which was once considered as the home to dinosaurs. Redwoods in California, US are now destroyed mainly because of the destruction due to water logging that occurs in that region. Now the next question is, with suitable examples, bring out the local winds, the impact of local winds on the climate of an area. Now let's first start with the winds. So when we talk about winds, you have under the classification, we classify one of those as local winds. Now local winds can be formed by three main areas. First is the conductive daytime heating. The next is the gravity downdraft that occurs, and finally is the unequal heating and cooling of the surface. So those are three of the basic reasons that impact or lead to formation of local winds. Now when we talk about certain local winds with examples, let's say Sirakku. Sirakku is a warm dry local wind. Now when Sirakku occurs, it leads to it is kind of injurious to the agriculture that is present there. Then you have Chinook, that is also known as the snow eater. It leads to melting of the snow that is present in the region. So Chinook is another local wind, and you have the impact on the local atmosphere that is seen. The most important you can work out is Santa Ana, found in California. It occurs between the mountain ridge in the region between San Gabrielis and San Bernardino, and this region, because of this wind, is prone to forest fires, and there is lot of devastation that is seen because of the forest fires. So you must cite down certain examples here. The next is, what are the characteristics that may make the CHCs a serious threat to ecosystem? Now CHC, the the hydrocarbons, lead to generation of greenhouse impact, and that leads to global warming and melting of snow. Between 1970 to 2004, there is a kind of 70% increase in the CHC gases. Now this diagram explains the amount of various gases. So you have the carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, chlorofluorocarbon 11, hydrofluorocarbons 23, and the perfluoromethane. And as you can see, you have the pre-industrial concentration and industrial and the concentration at 1998, and you can see the CFC consumption has increased from 0 to 268, and HCF from 0 to 14. That shows a significant amount of increase, and this increase has led to disruption or instability in the atmospheric system. The next is, what is base level? Explain the types of base level. Now base level, when I try to explain, is the lowest level at which you have the least velocity, or the velocity becomes less. So when you are when you have the water that flows, I can say base level, we usually talk about sea as a base level. So we talk about terms like below sea level and above sea level. However, to understand this better, we can work around certain examples. If I am walking at a very fast pace and suddenly I hit a crowd, what would happen? My speed of or my pace of walking would decrease. So similarly, when the river is flowing from the mountain, it is at a very high pace, but as it nears to the ocean region, the pace decreases. I can explain this in a similar fashion. If a child is walking, if a child is playing on a slide, the slide in the initial phase is very fast, but as you can see, the slide tapers down towards the bottom, and this tapering leads to decrease in the velocity. So here at this point, the velocity decreases and the speed of the child gets lesser. So rather than tumbling up towards the end of the slide, he can safely land out. Similarly is what happens with the sea. So when you have water that flows from the mountain, it slowly and gradually tapers down and its velocity decreases as it nears to the base level. Now when we talk about base level, we can classify it into two. One is the local base level, another is the ultimate base level. So ultimate base level, I can say, is with respect to sea. So ultimately all the water that's flowing merges with the sea. So you have sea as the ultimate base level. But when we talk about local base level, I can say the water is moving from the stream and merging into the lake. So at that point, lake becomes a local sea level, a local base level as compared to the sea. And then the water from the lake flows further and merges into sea. And finally moving on to a ultimate base level. So this is how we explain the concept of base level. Now this is one of the most interesting questions, and most of the students have asked me doubts regarding this question during the test series. So for all of those and other students, I would explain this question here. Now offshore acoustic study helped to development of the concept of sea floor spreading, and how? Now this all started when this questions like these are asked, it's better that you give a kind of historical perspective. So what happened during the World War II? You had the American boats that were present on the water. Now the enemy U-boats, which were submarines, were present, and these submarines used sonar as a technology, and this sonar technology used sound waves. So when this technology was used, you had sound waves that hit onto the boats, the American boats, and returned back. And this gave this U-boats an idea, the region where you had American boats, and that let the U-boats help destroy the American boats by means of torpedoes. Or I could say the destruction of the American boats became easier by means of the sonar technology. This idea was later used by Henry Hess when he talked about the concept of sea floor spreading. And he explained, if you have sound waves that are falling and they are reflecting from certain point, or they are bouncing off from certain point, that means there is some structure that is present in that region. And by means of sonar, he was the first to discover the mid-Atlantic ridge. So this is how you have the acoustic study that helped in development of the concept of seafloor spreading. Now besides this, you can also explain that how at Newport in Oregon coast in the United States, you have the three eruptions that occurred, and it was mainly the sound waves that helped predict the seafloor spreading, and that could help you gain more marks because it's a kind of recent thing that happened, and you could relate the contemporary issues with the conventional answers, and you can also see why such a question was asked in the examination. Okay, so this is something that you need to explain under this question. Now next is discuss dew point and the various forms of condensation. Now we have already covered this question in this lecture, so you can refer this. Now a brief recap: you have condensation that occurs in various forms. You have dew, fog, cloud formation, mist, rim, So these are some of the various forms of condensation. When we specifically talk about dew point, it mainly occurs when you have clear sky and there is no wind that exists in that region. So you have water drops that are formed by condensation, and they cool at the surface of the object they touch. So that is what is dew point. Now the next question is, bring out the relationship between climate and vegetation in mountain biome. Now when we talk about mountain biome, it's important, under mountain biome what we are focusing is mainly the altitude and not the latitude. So that's the primary thing that you must explain. So whatever occurs under a mountain biome, say a sloping roof of a house, and that is mainly due to the latitude, not the longitude. Again, altitude, not the latitude. And again, you have the presence of conifers that are present. So you can have the relation of climate with the vegetation. If you go further higher, the region would be devoid of vegetation. You can see the tundra type of vegetation that occurs on the top of the mountain due to low pressure and low melting point that exists there. Now the next question is, compare the subsidence and the glacial control theory for the formation of coral reef. Both these theories are explained in this video, so you can quickly refer that. The next question is, explain the level of noise pollution and the legislative measures to control it. Now noise pollution has been a significant problem in the recent days. Now government has set up a daytime limit and a nighttime limit. The daytime limit is applicable from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. is the day limit, that is this. And then you have, 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. is the night limit, and that is this. So you have the decibel values for the industrial, commercial, residential and the silent zone, and the permissible limit for the noise activities. Now government has brought around various acts and legislations in this regard. So you have Article 21, which talks about preservation of the natural heritage. You have Article 25 that talks about Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Then you have the Section 2 of the Pollution Air Act. You have the Air Pollution Act that was introduced in 1984. So you have to mention all the relevant acts and a brief summary on those. Then again, you have the Noise Pollution Regulation Act of 2000. In India, you have Nagpur, Mumbai and Kolkata as one of the noisiest cities of India. And then you have to mention again the Noise Control Act given by railways in 1980. Then you can mention case studies speaking about, for example, the Bihar, the Loudspeaker Act that talks about the use of loudspeakers and the permissible time for using the loudspeakers. Again, this is a criminal offense under the Indian Penal Code if you are found guilty of creating a public nuisance and the person who does the act of guilt. So you have various measures under noise pollution and the measures to control those. So you have to mention briefly all of those important acts and the highlights of those. So with this, we covered the section A of paper 1, 2013 paper. We'll be covering the remaining sections and the remaining papers in the further classes before the mains 2016. Stay tuned with our channel. Have a good day ahead.